I got saved at an early age. Can't remember how old I was, but it was early. Went to a place in Brooklyn, Maryland, which is a long ways away from Florida. Got saved, baptized. I remember getting baptized because my friend Jason Garrison was getting baptized too. We didn't know each other at the time. Sorry, Apple. Didn't have a towel. You know, who goes to baptism without a towel? So I could have been, you know, that uncompassionate guy that went, oh, you only got a towel, see you later. I got one, I'm done. No, I'll wipe off real quick. It's like, here, have a towel. We've been friends ever since. It had to be everybody, like, almost 30 years ago. I'm 36 now. Somewhere around that time frame. So, continued going to that church. Church was, church was okay. And my mom met a friend that, a husband that didn't believe in the Lord, didn't trust in the Lord, didn't want anything to do with the Lord. So he did was drink and do drugs. I beat my mom. I called him one day. Choking my mom out. Now, I think I'd be like 2 and 10. Maybe a couple years older. Because I was making my own sandwich. In the kitchen, and I saw him. I don't know what you need to make a sandwich, a knife, butter knife. So I remember I had a choice of stabbing him, which probably wouldn't have been real hard because his butter knife and, you know, I'm not strong. I mean, I wasn't weak, but I wasn't, you know, big I am now, you know, with semi muscles. Come on in.
Hey there, fellas.
Come on in, man. So I just dropped a knife and went down and called the cops. And I think he heard me going down the steps. And he gets to the steps, he goes, Mike, what are you doing? I just called my grandmother. First lie I've ever told. But it was in a good lie. So he tried to get it all situated. They went back and forth for like 11 years. You know, still beating her, still roughing her up, still not going to church. By this time I was getting in trouble in high school, elementary school, you know. If you go back to my old school in Brooklyn Park, Ball Park Elementary, you'll probably see me on the wall as one of the worst kids ever in that class, in the school, probably till today. mean, I was a hellraiser. If you dared me to do anything, I would have done it. Some girl goes, I dare to put teacher fart powder in teacher's coffee. Okay. Something then? Well, after recess. Some people say she was farting. It worked. That was the funny part. When I actually found out I did it, somebody snitched on me. But she told me in court, 6th grade. Could have killed her or something, gave her some, you know, blah, blah, blah. I was in 6th grade, I didn't care. So then I'm still on probation from that. Some guy goes, I dare you to pull that girl's pants down. I'm walking down the stairwell. Of course, the devil I am. Look up and the teacher's sitting there like this to me. Another suspension. That's in 7th grade. I don't know if I got... Well, yeah, 8th grade, I did get in a little trouble. With one teacher, Miss Sansone. Who thought you only get one pass every semester to go to the bathroom. I don't know how you guys know how long a semester is. It's a long time. I'm going to the bathroom when I feel like when I'm going to the bathroom. Whether you give it to me or not. So I kept getting sent out to the office. By the time they got to know me, they were like, just go back upstairs. Just go back. Like, as soon as I walk in the office. Get back up there. So by this time, I knew I needed a change. I wasn't doing any drugs. I wasn't drinking. I don't party. And I may have went out a few times here and there. But, like I said, no drugs, no alcohol. Ever. But then my mom met this guy that she used to go to school with. He was a Christian. Named Tom DeVore. And this guy was a biker for Jesus. Full blown biker outfit. And everything. Right on the side of the Grace Bible Baptist Church. And that's where it all started. You guys met my stepfather, right? Most of you. Me and him got saved on the same day.
That's awesome.
That's why our bond is so much tighter than being my real dad. Because I know he's been there for me from day one. We had our fights, we had our bickers. We had our scuffles. Because I was an idiot. So then they had a school, a Christian school. And you know, mom. You go to school there, I'm like, no. I said, I'm going to school all the way. I mean, I'm probably school all the way. think that's where all my friends are at. If I go there, I gotta meet new friends. That's gonna be tough. Not knowing how easy it was to meet friends. And I'm not boasting to all myself, but it is easy for me to meet friends. So I held off for 2 weeks and just figured out, did I want to do it? Did I start meeting people in the church and people, you know, the coach came up, basketball coach, you come to church and play basketball? Nobody's ever asked me to play basketball. I mean, I'm about the same height I was in high school. You coming out to play basketball? Thinking about it. Couple guys on the team. Yo, you coming out to play basketball? Like I'm a superstar or something. Like you see me play. Nobody seen me play. But it was that want. They want me there. So I told mom, I said, I'll go for a year. And I went, you know, 1 year turned into 4 years. To a great place that they built. At Grace Hall Baptist. And that's built my faith. Everything else because they were there when my sister was on heroin for 7 years. They popped us out humanistically and gave us stuff. They helped us out. They nagged the kids for a couple days so she couldn't find them. Not hiding it from them, but you gotta keep kids safe and parents on heroin so they don't, you know, do something stupid with kids. And then I met the other pastor at the church I went to called Cornerstone. And I started going there. Another beautiful church. In Maryland, God was all fired up, kind of like Mike Harrell. I mean, fired up. Jump on, I haven't saw Pastor Diaz yet, but he would jump over the pews. He would use, like, visions, like, we're Ravens fans, so. He'd jump up and have like a raven going, ga-ga, 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 with a raven. So he made it interesting. And again, they helped me with my faith walk. Because also they were there during the tough times with my sister. She struggled for a long time with heroin and drugs and prostitution. And and then coming here to Florida, I think I told my kids in small group, a youth, I said, if God wouldn't ordain this, I wouldn't be here suffering with you guys, or with you guys right now. God has ordained me coming here. As soon as I came down here, I found a job right away within, I'm gonna say, 3 days. you don't normally do that when you move into a different country or state, sorry. And and this trouble con. And this is one of the. This is probably the second struggle of my life I had to deal with. That's with my grandmother dying. My grandmother was my rock. She was my. She was my rock, she was my everything. If I wanted to talk to her, she'd be right there. If I wanted to chit chat, she'd be right there. But this is where it gets good. Because you all heard the testimony I did through all of this. That when I came out of surgery, Kevin goes, you got stage 4 colon cancer. I said, okay. Writing's on the wall, like, what do you want me to do? You want me to cry? You want me to get down and throw a tantrum? Kid, or you want me to keep praising the Lord the way I've been? I don't know about you, but kind of looks stupid during a tantrum. You know, 6'2" guy, almost 300, probably 290 now. Throwing a tantrum.
Getting some weight, are you?
And Ron Simmons is on a regiment. So I think just getting in touch with people that I know that I can trust and get that spiritual advice besides God. You can't go anywhere else besides God though. Outside the room, and I'm probably babbling on now.
You're fine.
So good.
So I'm gonna ask you, the very first thing that you told Kevin after coming out of surgery was what?
Tell me.
That God's got this, that you're not worried.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Through all this, have you told everybody?
Have I told everybody?
What have you told everybody?
What do you mean?
About your faith.
Oh, I just told them that, you know, like I told even the nurses and the doctors, and they were all like looking at me weird. The last 3 nights before surgery came. But I'm gonna take it back a little further. And when I was having stomach pains, I came to you and I was like, I'm having stomach pains. You actually gave me a pill. Alright, killing me now. Yeah.
Sorry, dude.
It's all your fault. Egghead.
And I felt sluggish about between 70% and 85% of the time. Like, I would come home and just crash on my bed. on days off I would sleep. And on those days where I didn't go even go to the house. But I still kept up on reading and praying. Because that's the only thing I really could do. I didn't have any energy for anything else. But 3 days before the surgery, I would keep the TV on so the nurses could see when they come in. They're not chirping over anything. I would have the music playing, David Crowder, playing Shakers, and anything else I can think of that worship God. And for 3 days straight, I said, Lord, this is yours. And he said, God, I don't want it anymore. I said, if it's, you're taking it, you're taking it. And I said, you want to help my family and all my friends. But this, I'm tired of fighting. I was like, I'm not going to stop fighting until you say so. So you give me 4 to 8 months, I'm going to fight 4 to 8 months. You give me 4 to 20 months, I'm going to fight for 4 to 20 months. I was like, God says plain and simple, and it hasn't wavered.
That's amazing.
Except today when I felt the crap and felt like going over.
Alright, well that's probably good. Can we pray for you?
Yeah.
Let me get Sean in here.
Anything else you would like to say, Mike?
Love you guys. All of you.
I love you too, man.
I love you too, man.
Make sure you tune us to fuel because I love fuel.